First of all, I would like to welcome everybody for coming to our first, hopefully of many, family education days. This day required a work of a lot of people, a lot of dedicated people. I won't thank them all individually, but I will thank Kenza, who has been the coordinator and doing all the work and getting all of us to end up in the same place at the same time. And we thank all her efforts. We are going to have sort of joint programs, and then we'll have some programs for the kids. So after I introduced Dr. Fasano, the kids could actually wander to the back, and they're going to follow all those people in the white shirts to have some activities for everybody. And then they'll come back at some point, and we'll hopefully enjoy the morning and early afternoon. To start off with, I'd like to introduce Dr. Fasano. Dr. Fasano is well known for those people who know about celiac disease, and he's been talking about this for innumerable years. Dr. Fasano does have the distinction of carrying the chair of Dr. Alan Walker. Alan is one of the founders of the field of pediatric gastroenterology and certainly my mentor as well. Dr. Fasano is the chief of pediatric gastroenterology at Mass General, among other titles. And he has been talking about celiac disease and research in celiac disease for many, many years. Is really at the forefront of much of the research, both clinical as well as basic research into the understanding the complexities of celiac disease, the best ways of treating it, and maybe some of the newer therapies that are out there. He certainly is a very entertaining speaker, and we're thrilled to have him. So if all the children, for those who are not interested in hearing Dr. Fasano, want to go out to the back, you can scoot to the back, and then we'll... And with that, I will introduce Dr. Fasano.
That's very tempted to fool the kids. Well, good morning, everybody. Again, thank to the Dr. Slavines for the nice invitation. That's very, very kind. And again, I think I want to start by saying how lucky you are that, you know, NYU decided really to make this initiative to have a close relationship with the patients, because in my experience, and now unfortunately it's quite long, that's the driving force. You know, the stuff happen if the grassroots of patients really take ownership to move the field forward. And again, you are in superb hands here, so take advantage of it. I want to start this little informal chat by giving you a little bit of history that is lost in transition, because people may not know where this all starts and what, you know, the celiac disease world evolved. And again, we sometimes, if we don't leave the history, we give stuff for granted. You know, this condition was known long time ago. There are people that claim that 2,000 years ago, a Greek physician described for the first time this condition, but was this young man here. It was a Dutch pediatrician that for the first time, and not long time ago, put together the concept of celiac disease being triggered by a specific, you know, element that is gluten, that is the cornerstone of the way that we treat celiac disease, and so on and so forth. With a quite interesting observation during World War II, when, you know, there was no food available, and flour was made with potato starch rather than with wheat. And he realized that during this time, the mortality was pretty high at that time. You know, one out of three kids would die of celiac disease, went to zero. To resurface after the war to 30-35%. And he put two and two together, said maybe that is something that is in the wheat that was driving this condition, and did a study that would not be feasible anymore because it would be not approved by any ethical committee. He took six of these kids, made them sick by giving, you know, gluten-containing grains, shown that these kids indeed got sick, took gluten out of the diet, they got better, and that's how he said, okay, this is it. The culprit here is the gluten-containing grains. And this happened in 1949. He published this data in 1951, and ever since that's been the cornerstone how we treat celiac disease. So we're not talking about a long history here. Now, fast forward to 2011, there's been a lot of, 2016, there's been a lot of commotion. There is a discussion, some not totally settled, what this condition is. Is it food allergy, food sensitivity, it's a food reaction? Well, now we know that this has all the rings of bells, all the pieces of what a typical autoimmune disease looks like. So it's definitely has the classical ingredients of the autoimmune recipe. Genetic predisposition, and quite peculiar actually, because you know, has some genes that must be there to develop the disease, and I'm pretty sure you heard about this HLA, DQ2, DQ8, without which pretty much you can't develop celiac disease. They're not specific for celiac, so one-third of the general population, they have it, but without those, you cannot develop celiac disease, and now we know the machinery why. You know, you have to have that in order to develop the disease. So peculiarity number one among all autoimmune diseases, yes, there is a genetic component, but the penetrance of this gene is extremely high. Peculiarity number two, the autoantigen, so the piece of our body that really is, you know, targeted in terms of immune reaction is also known, and this is a strange protein, is an enzyme that lives in the cells, it's called tissue transglutaminase. As a matter of fact, the antibodies against this enzyme is a very robust diagnostic tool that we use nowadays. But what sets celiac disease totally apart from any other autoimmune disease is the only, thanks to that physician, is the only autoimmune disease for which we know the trigger. We don't know why people come down with diabetes, MS, Hashimoto. So, but here we know that, you know, it is gluten the culprit. Matter of fact, if you go gluten-free, and therefore you eliminate this enemy that triggered this cascade of events that leads to the auto-destruction intestine, everything goes back to normal. Symptoms go away, these antibodies, these autoantibodies will go away, and most of the time, the damage of the intestine that is the, you know, proof of the autoimmune insult goes away. And again, this seems to be a given and, you know, may not excite you that much, but this is creating and still creates a tremendous amount of debate in the scientific community, because this proves that autoimmune diseases are treatable, provided you stop this interplay between the genes and the environment, that we can, we see the disease, we cannot yet. For the others, you can stop the autoimmune process. So this is revolutionary as a concept. Now, when these two elements that come together, the clinical outcome that we had in mind was this. So, a pediatric condition with GI disorders and, you know, with this list of typical, you know, symptoms. So, that's what we had in mind in terms of celiac disease. Those kids, they are pretty much the picture of malnourished kids, like the one that we see in the third world country nowadays. Why they look like this? Not because they don't have food, they have, but they cannot make use of the food at all. They can eat as much as you want, but because the intestine is destroyed, its function, particularly, you know, digesting and absorbing food stuff, is jeopardized, and therefore stuff just goes through. So the ultimate outcome is the same, but not because they don't eat, but because they eat, they cannot make use of it, of what they're eating. That was, for many, many years, the picture that we have now in mind, paradigm of celiac disease. And with that picture in mind, we made statements, including the fact that celiac disease did not exist in the United States, because we were looking for kids like this, and indeed, they were not. The reason why is because celiac disease, over time, turns to be a much more complex condition. As a matter of fact, nowadays, this is celiac disease. Definitely, if we see anything like this, we call the students, we take the iPod, and take pictures, because this is unique. Why there was the rule in the past. What we see now is what we call a systemic condition. So in other words, through the fight, the battle starts on the gut's battlefield, and that's what's really trigger everything. But this fight can spread everywhere in the body. Any tissue organ can be involved. As a matter of fact, the most frequent way that disease presents itself, even in kids, is this: iron deficiency anemia, does not respond with iron supplementation, and with that, you know, chronic fatigue and so on and so forth. That's the most frequent way the disease presents itself. No GI symptoms whatsoever. It should not surprise, you know, because, you know, as you see, you know, the intestine is much more complex than we believed before, and, you know, that can explain something that you see over there. Bottom line, you know, long time ago, unfortunately, this is the time flies, celiac disease was defined. I defined this as a clinical chameleon. And again, this was, you know, 2003. This was at the time in which people still were debating if you can have celiac disease being obese, or being African-American, or be with no GI symptoms, because the paradigm, again, white, young kids with GI symptoms, that's it. Nobody else can have it, you know? So again, when this was put out there, it said, look, guys, you didn't really open your horizon to really appreciate the how complex is the condition, how frequent is there, and who is affected. You really need to just trash this, you know, dogmas in the toilet and start all over again. Open your mind to something that seems to be much more complex. Now, what I'm going to do today, again, I will drive you through these milestones that brought us to wherever we are now, and through the kaleidoscope of what we've seen through our center and many other centers like the one here in New York, starting with the recipe to develop celiac disease, because that's what we start to learn. Knowing that gluten was the culprit, knowing that some genes have been there, we're able to study more in details, you know, the recipe of celiac disease. And what we learn is that, you know, the recipe of celiac disease, and therefore all the other immune diseases, is much more complex than genes, environment equal the disease. There's much more than that. And at least there is a third element, and now there is a fourth, and probably a fifth element that comes into the story. So you have to be genetically predisposed for sure. You have to be exposed to an environmental trigger, in this case gluten, not an autoimmune disease we don't know, that is mismanaged by the immune system because of genetic makeup. The immune system, imagine, is an army with soldiers that are the immune cells. They are there to defend us against the enemy. In autoimmunity, including celiac disease, when exposed to the enemy, the weapons, rather to be pointed against the enemy to get rid of it, is pointed against ourselves. And depending on the organ that's targeted, you can develop different autoimmune diseases. The third element that turned to be important was, okay, these two worlds, genes living in our body, environmental triggers that live outside in the world, need to physically interact. And this normally does not happen because we have mechanisms of defense, barriers that keep these two worlds separated. Particularly the intestinal barrier that you see in a moment is the largest interface that we have with the environment. These barriers needs to not be functional anymore. So that allows these two worlds actually to physically see each other. So in other words, loss of intestinal barrier function seems to be an important situation. I told you about these genes. I have to say that we made a tremendous amount of effort to find, quote unquote, the genes for celiac disease, as the genes for many autoimmune diseases, now that we have the tools to do that. We have the toys that we can play with. We are able to, you know, screen the entire human genome, and with our major disappointment, there is no such a thing, the genes for celiac disease, because the more we search, the more we find. So we are now almost 100 genes for celiac disease, 300 for other conditions like, you know, Crohn's disease and so on and so forth. And when we found a gene in one population that we tried to validate another population, not always they really pin out to be reproducible. So it turns out that the gene per se is not important. It's what this gene does for living that is important. And because the same function can be attended by many, many different genes, then there is a chance that if there is a gene, for example, that control how these immune cells they work, in one person, maybe a total different gene that does the same function in another person. So see how complex is the story. It suffices to say, though, that again, this HLA is absolutely necessary. Without this piece of the genetic puzzle, no matter if you have all the others, you cannot develop celiac disease. I told you, so this is the genetic. Then I told you about this barrier function. And again, if you think about the gut, it's much more complex than we believed before. First of all, it's a long tube. In adults, it's roughly 20 feet long. And in the past, it was conceptualized like a sort of floor that's covered by these, you know, tiles. Why? Because the intestine is made by single layer cells. That's it. They separate us from the environment. So and it protects us. And again, the idea was everything that needs to happen in terms of communication between us and the environment has to be done with these passages, with this trafficking of molecules within the cell. In between cells, nothing could go through. Why? Because everything was supposed to be sealed, cement, like the grout that you have in between, you know, tiles. And again, if you take the intestine, you stretch on the floor, you cover a double tennis court. So it's a huge interface. And at the beginning, again, the physiologist perceived this largest interface necessary just to attend the key function of the intestine, namely to digest, absorb foodstuff. Much more complex than that. We don't need that huge, surface. As a matter of fact, people that have intestinal resection, they still can function relatively well if they don't have a huge resection of the intestine in terms of digesting and absorbing foodstuff. There are many other functions that require such a large interface, including, you know, the negotiation with the environment, deciding who comes in and who does not in terms of what we call antigen sampling. And then, you know, again, a major change of this picture came when people look more carefully at the space in between cells. And in the mid-70s, a Japanese group said, you know what, there are no sealed places here. There is no cement or walls in between these cells. They are doors, most of the time closed. But because they are doors, it's implicit the concept that they sometimes can be open. And a common denominator, all the diseases that has to do with autoimmunity, these doors, they don't function anymore. Rather than stay closed all the time and open only for a short period of time to allow stuff under tidally control to come from the environment into our body, these doors are stuck open and there is a flood of stuff that comes in. It's like the levees are gone and everything comes in. And again, if you have this massive amount of junk that comes in your body, depends what kind of genetic background you have, you may develop an autoimmune disease. What was interesting was that for the following 20 years, there was a wealth of science to understand how these doors are made. So all the components of these doors now are clear, and just came back from Berlin, and the numbers, you know, goes on and on and on, and it's quite remarkable how complex are these doors. One information that was missing was who opens and closes this door. So what is the key? And that's how we, by serendipity, stumbled upon this molecule now almost 15 years ago that we called zonulin, that remains the only physiological modulator that decides if and when this door needs to be open. And turns also that this molecule is the one that goes out of control in many autoimmune diseases, including celiac disease. And, you know, we will revisit this in a moment when we talk about alternative treatment. So we visited the genetics, we visited the barrier function. What about the trigger, you know, gluten? Well, that's another interesting story. And again, there is a lot of confusion and a lot of fantasies, very few facts about, you know, gluten. Yes, no, it's toxic for everybody. It's toxic only for people with celiac disease. No, it's toxic for people with celiac disease and many, maybe other people and so on and so forth. What are the facts? And what has been the confusion that has been fueled by taking these facts out of the context of the entire discussion here? The fact, it is true that human beings were not meant to eat gluten. As a matter of fact, for the 2.5 million years of evolution, our ancestors have been mainly gluten-free. The food that human beings have been evolved with were fresh fruits, fresh vegetables, lean meat, tubers, nuts, oil at a certain point, but that's it. So gluten really came only in the picture 10,000 years ago, when we changed our lifestyle from, you know, nomadic lifestyle, hunter, you know, gatherers, to settlers, and agriculture was developed. We start to play with seeds and so on and so forth, and that's how we developed this tribe of grass family that's called the Ordi, to which wheat, rye, and barley belong to. And these are the ones that are overloaded with gluten. Okay? Now, if you take out of the context, people would say, okay, if that's the case, if we are not evolved to eat gluten, that explains why we got in trouble with eating gluten, and we all got in trouble. That's absolutely not factual. So, but why gluten is toxic? So what is the problem? After all, this is a protein from food. and therefore should be something good for us. Why eventually, at least in a subgroup of individuals, this protein triggers such, you know, a nasty reaction that leads to, you know, this clinical outcome that characterizes celiac disease, autoimmune disorders. Well, again, remember, this story started here, roughly. So the current Low Turkey, 10,000 years ago, that's when the settlers came in. And this is what we start to do with the grains. You know, the at that time, and then the Romans and the Greeks and the Egyptians, and these are the grains that they're eating at that time. Only 14 chromosomes for 50,000 genes, roughly 4% of the dry weight of this wheat was gluten, okay? And over time, middle age, you know, roughly, there was another reiteration in which we came from here to here. So double the number of chromosomes, double the number of genes, and now we have another permutation of this wheat that was much richer in gluten, roughly 8%. Why agronomers, you know, farmers were doing this? Very simple, to increase the yield of the plant. That's all. They didn't care about anything else. They were trying to make more out of this. And matter of fact, here, now the seeds part of the plant that was only 1/10 here, now is 3/10 here. And finally, 400 years ago or so, the last permutation that we went from tetragidum to a stivum, 42 chromosomes and 150,000 genes, roughly 12% of dry weight is gluten. And now this makes 1/3 of the plant. Ever since, there's been no change whatsoever of the genetic of this plant. Why I'm telling you all this, because this can be tremendously boring. Well, because there are people that claim that these epidemics of celiac disease and many gluten-related disorders are driven by industry that's genetically engineering grains that makes us all sick. That's not true. I'm not an agronomer, but you know, last year, the American Academy of Science, the highest, you know, entity that look after, you know, the science that is produced in the United States and worldwide, posed the question: do we have, you know, genetically modified grains that really can respond to the issue that we are in these epidemics? And the answer was, absolutely not. There is no genetically engineered wheat. There is a genetically engineered maize, but not wheat. So everything that has been changing over time is purely done by universities or farmers or agronomers to try simply to increase the yield of the plant. Said that, of course, there have been 3 times more gluten now than 2,000 years ago. That's true. But that's not what is probably fueling the problem here. What is fueling the problem is the way that we handle these grains, maybe. And we can revisit this in a moment. Matter of fact, you see here, you know, in 1500s, look at how the plant looks like. Granted, you know, these are shorter people at that time. But the height of the plant was pretty much the height of a man. Now, they are much lower than that. Again, because of this, you know, permutation of, you know, these cultivars that have been mixed and matched with the pure goal to increase the yield of the plant. That's it. That's what the agronomers were trying to do. Why gluten is so special? Why can cause trouble? Because it's a one-of-a-kind protein. As a matter of fact, technically it's not even a protein. It's a mixture of protein. So gluten is made by 2 key components, gliadin and glutenins, both toxic for people with celiac disease. The glutenins are the ones that make this, you know, these fibers that create these chambers in which the blob of gliadin is accommodated. Not only that, but when you take this, you make this as a flour, you put yeast and you put water, you generate air, gas that is entrapped in these chambers, and that's how you make the dough. If you do this with rice, it doesn't go anywhere. But with this, because of this huge elasticity, it comes up and it's puffy and it's beautiful and so on and so forth. Yeah, well, you know what I'm talking about. The other thing that is peculiar about these proteins is they cannot be digested completely by human beings just because we didn't evolve. to eat this stuff. So imagine, you know, proteins like this one. This is a prototype of gluten that is called alpha-gliadin, like a pearl necklace. The job to make use of protein is to break this necklace in pieces and then eventually peel this pearl one at a time, because only the pearls that are the amino acids can be brought in. The pieces that are undigested, not only under normal circumstances, cannot come in, but if they do, are perceived as enemies because our substances are not belong to our body, and the immune system will react against them. Now, again, because of the peculiarity of this protein, we don't have the scissors to break it, as we do with all other proteins. We can cut in pieces what we call peptides, but not breaking completely and just peel off, you know, these single pearls. So I color-coded some of these unbreakable pieces here. For example, this guy here that was discovered, you know, almost 20 years ago, it will induce death of cells. So in other words, we'll tell the cell to suicide itself, kill yourself. So, and it's quite interesting. This yellow piece here, it's what we call a super antigen. So in other words, when you're exposed to this, you unleash an immune response that's totally not proportional to the risk that you incur when you're exposed to this. These two blue here are able to communicate the cells and make zonulin, this protein that makes intestinal leak, to be released, so that, you know, gluten can open a shortcut for itself to come from the lumen intestine, so outside, to inside. And finally, this green one, it was the last one that was, you know, determined to be important as a molecule that called on the battlefield soldiers, our immune cells, to start this process of inflammation. So, and again, you read this, and that's the reason why I'm putting it here. It is true that everybody that eats gluten will make zonulin to release, and therefore they have an intestine that leaks. But not everybody that do that will have clinical consequences. Why? Because if I don't have any gluten-related disorder, eat gluten-containing stuff, I will leak, but my gates will open and close very fast, the way they are supposed to, and everything is fine. For somebody that has defects, you know, again, there are many autoimmune diseases that have been linked to this, maybe that eating gluten will keep these gates longer and therefore cut a shortcut to other molecules, not only gluten, God knows what else, that will eventually, with the door closed, will not be able to come through, but with the door open, will come into the body and will be visible to the immune system. I'm going to pause just for a second to make sure that I'm not talking too technical. Am I losing anybody here? Are we sure?
Yes.
Otherwise, I start all over again. No, I have a flight, so I'm not going to do that. No way. Another major milestone was reached now almost 15 years ago. That was diagnostic. So the more seasoned physicians that you have here will remember the story. There was nothing really solid to make the diagnosis of celiac disease other than some esoteric tests that were not very specific. Tests that were telling simply, well, the intestine is not working the way they're supposed to, but not telling us that that dysfunction was associated with celiac disease. The major breakthrough was indeed with the advent of this unbelievable test, particularly the one that we use nowadays, this anti-TTG antibodies, that is extremely robust. I mean, we rarely have in our toolbox for diagnostic purposes in any kind of disease, you know, tests that are so good in terms of sensitivity, i.e. picking up everybody that has the problem, making no mistakes to have false negative, or specificity that you know, they are positive only for celiac and nothing else, so that you don't have false positive bringing somebody in diagnosis that doesn't have celiac disease. So really, really, really robust, you know, tests that we have now. Of course, where is the future? Where we're going with this? And I'm going to tell you this toward the end in a few minutes. The future was, you know, can we develop a diagnostic algorithm to avoid intestinal biopsy? This algorithm has been developed particularly in pediatrics. Now it's under scrutiny because, you know, there is a second thought. Should we not, you know, do the endoscopy? I'm pretty sure that some of you guys want to ask about that and so on and so forth. But again, what is really the future that is in the pipeline? Is not fantasy anymore, but it's coming. are the possibility of what we call disease interception. Knowing that somebody's at risk for celiac disease, having a crystal ball to look in the future, say, you know what, you will take the wrong turn because X, Y, and Z, and you will see in a moment what is X, Y, and Z, while you will, somebody else does not, okay? Another major milestone that was achieved, again, almost 15 years ago, was the epidemiology of celiac disease. Again, you'd give for granted, if you've been diagnosed in the past 10 years, that this was always a big deal. It was not. You know, 10, 15 years ago, the exception to celiac disease was not only that you have to be white, but very fair white. You have to live in the north of Europe, close to Santa Claus, and you have to be a kid to have celiac disease. So it was a niche, bottom line, of people that had to be right there. Scandinavia, that was, or Ireland, that was, you know, the backbone where celiac disease was supposed to occur. And yet, the two key ingredients of the recipe, i.e. the grains that induce celiac disease and the genes necessary to develop it, were present everywhere in the world. How come that these two will translate in the clinical outcome of celiac disease only here? That was really, really, really very difficult to explain. As a matter of fact, at that time, it was considered extremely rare, was considered pediatric, the condition that fluctuates in space and time, for example, a great, great example of this unconceivable dichotomy that we're living at that time was the situation, for example, between Ireland, where the disease was extremely frequent, and Denmark, that was right there, you know, just down the road of Ireland, and was much, much more rare. Same genetic background, eating the same stuff, and yet there was such a different, huge difference. What was the difference? Well, because again, remember at that time, the diagnosis and the definition of celiac disease was a pediatric condition with GI symptoms. It turns that in Ireland, that's the way the disease presented itself. In Denmark, disease presented itself more like here. Anemia, stomach ache, you know, joint pain, headache, but not much of the GI symptoms that we typically had in mind. And this probably, it became the cornerstone study, published in 2003, turns to be the most frequently cited paper on celiac disease, in which for the first time the flag celiac was planted on the North American, you know, soil, showing that we were not different, as we believed in the past, from Europe. Same prevalence, roughly 1% of the general population, 3-5 times more if you are at risk because you have a relative with celiac, or if you have GI symptoms or extra-intestinal symptoms that being related to celiac disease. Now, probably the major milestone, and this is a path that started almost 10 years ago, was, you know, to find alternative or integrated treatment to the gluten-free diet. So in other words, now we start to really have the idea, the complexity of the toy. This cartoon explains the chain of events that lead to celiac disease. They are so simple that I'm not going to discuss it. I didn't understand myself this stuff here. But anyhow, it suffices to say that in 2005, after years of research, we passed from a possible target that was only this dot here, number one, take gluten out of the diet, to possible 10 targets. All the steps that we learn that are necessary to lead to the auto-destruction of the intestine. So there were 9 extra targets that we, outside the gluten-free diet, that we were totally unaware. And the following 10 years have been fueled by research to go after to these different kind of targets to see if there was any way to come up with something alternative or integrated to the gluten-free diet. Now, again, imagine the fact that some of these steps are common to many other autoimmune diseases. So this effort was not just peculiar to find a solution to celiac disease, but possibly could be exploited for any autoimmune disease there or for any solution right now because we don't know the trigger that brings to this disease fruition. So if you look at the clinicaltrial.gov to have a sense how activist in this science of clinical trials for celiac disease, you will have a sense there's been an explosion over time. There was zero in 2005, and the last time that I looked, it was at the end of 2015, more than 165 trials have been in the making for something that has to do with the celiac disease business. And again, if you look at the schematic of the story that I told you, this is the villi, so this sphingolite protrusion, this is the external world where gluten comes, and this is the inside of the body with immune cells and ulna yards. You know, there have been, you know, possible intervention for, you know, act intraluminally. So in other words, we do not have this scissors, this enzyme to digest gluten, but some bacteria they do. So some people have been using these bacteria-derived enzymes to completely dismantle gluten so it will become less toxic. The stuff that came out from our lab is the fact that, again, zona increased the permeability of the gut and therefore starts all the chain of events that leads to, you know, what to destroy the intestine. If you block zona, you block at the very beginning this chain of events. And then stuff that has to do with immune cells, so in other words, act directly on the soldiers that kill their own cells to try to immunosuppress them, or biologics of different, you know, category in terms of what they do to calm down the immune system. Bottom line, and again, this is, you know, pretty updated. Of the 171 registered clinical trials, 36 were focused on treatment. So forget about the rest, just a second. Of this, 34 have been completed, two are still active. And you see the different approaches that I mentioned to you. Unfortunately, this one, Alvine Pharmaceutical, that was one of the most active, you know, enterprise to dismantle these toxic element of gluten using enzymes from bacteria, failed the last phase two trial, so they closed shop. And that's unfortunate. But hopefully there's gonna be other, you know, approaches similar that will keep going. Alba Therapeutics, that is the one that blocked zonulin, is entering phase three trial in November. So, and that's pretty much, you know, the summary of what I just told you. So where are we? So some are just started phase one, some are, you know, eventually initiating phase three, some are preclinical. All this to say, we went in only 10 years, that seems to be an eternity, but it's a drop in the bucket in developing drugs from zero drugs that were targeting celiac disease to more than 170 clinical trials. And again, I want to also give you a sense of how this works. To go from here, so preclinical, to go in the pharmacy and buy something, in general, it's something that takes, in general, 15 years, roughly, sometimes more, okay? And $1.4 billion with a B dollars. Why? Because the system is extremely inefficient. You start with 1,000 possible molecules, 2 or 3 will make through this entire process. So it is extremely inefficient and time consuming. Matter of fact, though, is that we are almost there with this. Alvine, again, is not there anymore. And then there are this, for example, this vaccine trial that's quite interesting now. It's coming almost at this phase here. So there is stuff that's moving during the pipeline. I'm going to finish up, with what I believe are the most exciting parts of the story here. So what I told you so far is that, okay, what we were, so how this really, you know, pan out. What we are right now, how much we learn about the toy and what we can do it. Now I'm telling you where we're going from here. And one of the most remarkable lessons that I learned by studying celiac disease and comorbidities associated with it is that contrary to what we were taught, contrary to what was the general assumption, the fact that I'm born with the genes that make me at risk for celiac disease or, you know, diabetes, MS, Hashimoto, Alzheimer, or even breast cancer, you name it, is not destiny that I will develop that disease. The fact that I have that genes doesn't mean that sooner or later that is going to happen to me. If it's going to happen or not, it will be totally, totally depending on my lifestyle, how I evolve as a human being. And again, of course, if you have the genetics, that predisposition, that breathing on my neck would not go away. But if that translates in actual disease or not, really depends the way that we live our lives. And we learned this by this kind of interesting exercise. Have you heard about this hygiene hypothesis? Everybody knows what I'm talking about? No, okay. For those few that don't know, to make a very long and complicated story short, once upon a time there was something that we called the backyard. Do you remember the backyard? You don't know what I'm talking about, I'm sorry. But for the people that are a little bit older, that was the place that we used to play. You know, we went out there, put the hands on the dirt, in the mouth, in the dirt, scratch the butt, and then the mouth. In doing all this, we were, you know, teaching the immune system to defend us. Now, we don't have that anymore. The backyard is the couch, the video games, and if somebody tried to sneeze, and mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, everybody comes and sanitizes the business. So you don't have a chance that the immune system really to get strong and defend us against these enemies. So that's the essence of the hygiene. In other words, we become too clean for our own goods, and we pay the price for this. And this was really nicely summarized by this paper, this individual that, you know, just simply observed something interesting. Starting in the 50s, we went out at war against this infection. We realized that these microorganisms are killing us, and we have to defeat them at all costs. And we implement the hygiene, and then we start, you know, vaccination, and then antibiotics, and so on and so forth. And we were extremely good in terms of what we're able to achieve. So diseases that were travesty, plagues at that time, like rheumatic fever, epa, TB, mumps, measles, they went down. So completely gone. However, and only in the industrialized countries where the implementation of the hygiene was made, we start to see the epidemics of these chronically inflammatory diseases, mainly autoimmune diseases like MS, Crohn's, type 1, asthma, and I can go on and on and on. Interesting, in other words, we don't die fast of infectious disease anymore, we die slowly of autoimmune diseases. That's what we did. And again, same trend for celiac disease, no exception here. And again, how this is fueled was not clear, because again, same genes we're talking about now, 25 years, this is a lifespan in which you can't, you know, blame genetic mutation. It's way too short. The same generation, definitely the grains are not, you know, driving this, because again, the grains didn't change. So double every 15 years. And again, nobody understood what the heck was going on here. What was the epidemics? And then one other, you know, disturbing observation. Some of these developing countries in which these epidemics were not happening start to implement hygiene. They were cleaner. So some countries in South America, like Chile and Mexico, some in North Africa, like Egypt and so on, and yet they don't see these epidemics. So being too clean was not anymore to be blamed for these epidemics. So of all the stuff that I have to tell you, probably this is the most important slide that we learned recently. If you're lucky, if you're really lucky, you are on the left side of this slide. So you're born the way that Mother Nature decided that we have to be born. You feed the kids food and not God knows what, because most of the time when we give them junk food or stuff that we take from the freezer section of the supermarket, we don't know what the heck is in there. No little infections, very scarce and very, targeted use of antibiotics and so on and so forth. All this will keep this ecosystem of microorganisms that live with us from birth to death. I'm pretty sure that you heard about this microbiome and so on and so forth, in great balance. And it's the microbiome that in the first 1,000 days of life teach the immune system, if and well, to unleash weapons that translate in collateral damage that we call inflammation. A balanced microbiome will teach the immune system to set the bar way up. So you really need to be in extremely danger to create inflammation. And that will put us in a situation in which we stay healthy, what we call technically tolerogenic. If we are out of the luck, you are on the left, this other side of the slide, you're born by C-section, no food that you can call food, a lot of infection, all the antibiotics. Bottom line, you put these poor folks in a total disarray with this imbalance, what we call dysbiosis. An imbalanced microbiome teaches the immune system to unleash inflammation even for trivial reasons. So the bar is so low that you have the possibility to be inflamed all the time, all the time. And that, on a specific genetic breakdown, puts you over the edge and will make you to develop these conditions. That's the only way that you can explain epidemics like celiac disease. That's the only way that you can explain why homozygous twins, same genes, they eat the same gluten stuff. One develops celiac disease that the other one does not, because there is no 100% concordance, but there's only 75% concordance. That, in other words, would explain why some kids develop the disease at 2 and other people develop the disease at 72. What I just explained is a very complex concept that we call epigenetics. So in other words, pressure from the environment to change the behavior of our genes, to do stuff that eventually you have potential to do, but it's not for sure that you end up to do or not. That's the reason why I'm saying, if we develop this disease, it's not because we're genetically predisposed. It's our lifestyle that eventually we dictate that. And Mother Nature also tells us that's the case. For example, if you look at the composition of the breast milk, this HMO that is not on the health insurance is human monoglycoside. It's the richest sugar component of the breast milk. Totally useless to feed the baby. The baby cannot make use of these sugars. We don't have the way to use them. What these sugars they do there? They feed the microbiome. They feed the bacteria that live in peace with us, the one that will make the bar to be very high. So you see how we imprint through mother's milk the microbiome that defend us rather than create the problem. And when we start to ask ourselves, you know, where are the reason of the epidemics, and we start to really look at all these elements again, people said the quality of gluten exchange, the quantity of gluten exchange, the time, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. We did a study that it was the only way to answer the question. 700 neonates at risk follow from birth for 10 years. And this study told us nothing. There was totally negative outcome. So all the questions that we asked, we didn't have an answer for. So we thought that there was a window opportunity in which you have to give gluten to minimize the risk between 4 to 7 months. It doesn't work. We thought that giving a small amount of gluten early will induce, you know, the immune system to tolerate gluten. It did not work. We thought that delayed the introduction of gluten to a year so that you give it time to the immune system mature. And a lot of families, they do that. Useless. You just delay the onset of disease, but, you know, you don't prevent it. The only two things that come out was GI infection seems to be more frequent in people that eventually develop celiac disease. And number two, genetics. This HLA that I was telling you about seems to be important. So if you are Joe Schmo, 1% of chances. Your first degree relative of somebody with celiac disease, 10%. But if you're first degree relative and you have two copies of this HLA DQ2, 40%. So it really comes up a lot. But still there's 60% of the risk is not explained. So with that in mind, this is frozen now. I can't go any further than that. That means that with that in mind, we focus on the microbiome. We look now, it's possible that this microbiome is doing this, and we did this study, and sure enough, indeed, that's the case. And again, now the inexplicable can be explained. When the Human Genome Project was completed, we realized that genetically speaking, we are junk, rudimental. We are at the bottom of the evolution. Only now we've been downgraded. It's not even 25, it's 23,000 genes. That's it. You know, a worm that we go fishing with, 75,000 genes. 75,000 genes, 3 times more than we do. The plant that makes celiac disease, gluten, 150,000 genes. So how we can be so sophisticated? How we can be so complex that, you know, and yet we are genetically at the bottom of the scale here. The only way, once again, is to appreciate that we are the complex of two worlds. So in other words, we and the bacteria, the microorganisms that live with, were a unity, and we influence each other, so much so that now we talk about two genomes that we inherited. The human genome, the one that is fixed, will not change over time. The 23,000 genes, it comes from our parents. And if there are genes defective and put me at risk for celiac disease or, you know, Alzheimer's or Hashimoto, whatever, they're there. Can't do anything about this. But if this will become disease or not, it depends on the other genome that we inherited, the microbiome. If we're lucky, it comes from our mother, because if that microbiome lives in peace with her, it'll probably live in peace with us. But it's extremely dynamic, can change. In those first 1,000 days of life, if we do wrong things, we make the microbiome composition in a way that is going to touch this genome all the time, because inflammation is all the time, and therefore we'll make that potential of disease to be actuality. But if we do right things, if we keep this in balance, we keep these genes, you know, out of business. So to explain what I just told you in a very simple terms, imagine the human genome as a piano with 23, 25, 30,000 genes, whatever they are. One for each, you know, a note for each gene. Let's say you have to play 300 notes to develop celiac disease. Who does play the piano is the microbiome. And while the piano is there, will not change. If you have those 300 notes that they are not working anymore, you can't trade that in. But the piano player change all the time. So you can eventually have Elton John that touch 200 notes of the 300, and you don't play the song celiac disease. And then you do something that will eventually make this microbiome to change, become Chopin, for out of balance, will touch all 300 notes, and now you play the celiac disease song at any time of your life, even at 70. And, you know, take, you know, celiac disease, put any other disease, and looks like that that's the story. Meaning that why we don't have the power to change the destiny of the genes that we have been inherited from our parents, we do have the power to decide if these genes will become functional to put us in trouble or not. And matter of fact, the NIH just entrusted us with a very large grant to do exactly that. Follow these kids from birth, look at all this, you know, their genes, the microbiome, other elements, environment, and ask the question, can I know beforehand who's taking the wrong turn that goes left rather than right, so that down the road will eventually develop celiac disease? And if that's the case, can I bring this back, not by changing the genome that I can't do, but change these other elements, particularly the microbiome, so that those genes will not be touched? So we'll see how this goes. I'm going to finish up with, you know, something that, again, I'm pretty sure that you heard. We were on the premises that the gluten-free diet was appropriate only for people with celiac disease. Nobody else had to be in the business to go on a gluten-free diet. But, you know, we all see that, you know, the gluten-free diet compared to other popular diet like low-carb or fat-free is now by far the most popular diet in the United States and probably in the world, more than $10 billion in annual sales. Who is fueling this? I mean, this is not celiac. If you look at this graph that is, again, from Google, that I just came up, you know, not long ago, it's amazing that almost 100 million people, one out of three Americans, at some point during the year would try a gluten-free product. Who are these people? Well, why they go gluten-free? There is definitely a fat factor. No question about that, you know. There is no question that if there are icons like this that go gluten-free, people feel, well, if it's good for her, if it's good for him, it's got to be good for me as well. Okay, so the fat question, it's a given. But this is not just fat. There is something else that's going on here because, you know, this is hard to believe that everybody went nuts. Maybe in California they do, but not everywhere. So if you look at this 100 million, you try to ask the question, who are these? 50 of the 100, they go gluten-free because they think that it's healthier. And again, it depends what you do in the gluten-free diet. If gluten-free means that you cannot eat junk food anymore, you have the food to cook from scratch, you know, again, that you can't embrace, in other words, the Western, you know, lifestyle, that's good for you. If, on the other hand, you start to use and abuse gluten-free products, they are hypercaloric, a lot of fat, and so on and so forth, that is not good for you. The other thing that is interesting, that's a typical our phenomenon here, that 24 million of these people that go gluten-free, they do that because they think that they lose weight. Now, because it's called diet, so that implies that you lose weight with that. And guess what? If you do that by using, you know, gluten-containing counterparts, gluten-free, no, you don't lose weight. If anything, you gain weight. You know, if you take a Oreo cookie that is 70, you know, calories, a Oreo cookie that is gluten-free has 210 calories. So same size, same thing is, but three times more calories. So no, you don't lose, you gain weight. And who is diagnosed with celiac disease and starts the gluten-free diet knows well that one of the major problems that you face is to gain weight when you go gluten-free. The last three categories are probably the most interesting one. 9 million, they said they have mainly GI symptoms that resolve only going gluten-free. 7, mainly ex-intestinal symptoms they resolve only if they go gluten-free. I know there is a piece of the pie here, there is a line, but trust me, it's there. These are the only ones that have celiac disease, and therefore, for sure, they need to be on a gluten-free diet. So it's a minuscule part of the business. So the gluten-free diet, bottom line, is divided in consumers that they eat the gluten-free, not for medical necessity. I have full respect to them. And by the way, for the celiac community, they've been very good because, you know, they fuel research on the gluten-free products, the palatability increased, the price came down, the amount of calories also came down. So that was good as an epiphenomenon. The problem that I have with that is that, again, people that make even jokes of, you know, on talk shows that this is a fat diet, and they are very superficial when they do that because they don't realize that for people with celiac disease, the gluten-free diet is like insulin for diabetics. If they can, people with celiac disease would never embrace this diet. That's a medical necessity, and again, I have full respect, and I also laugh at this, you know, talk show. But you know, they are a little bit superficial when they say, "Okay, this is a fad," and make fun of all this. Now, you know, the people they have to go for medical necessity are divided in three major subgroups. You know, one that is very dear because he's an expert to Yossi Levy here. That's the wheat allergy. The other one is the autoimmune process that we discussed so far. And then there is this other entity that now we call non-celiac gluten sensitivity. The amount of people affected by that is questionable. We don't know, and so on and so forth. There have been not one, not two, but four consensus conferences to try to define what is gluten sensitivity and, you know, see if it exists, how do you diagnose, and so on and so forth. And again, definitely there is an immune response. So in other words, the immune cells, they do something when they see gluten that is different than what they do when they in people with celiac disease. It's still an immune response, but it's different. And the symptoms are very much overlapping with the one of celiac disease. So you have GI symptoms like a stomach ache and diarrhea or you know, constipation sometimes, but you also have ex-intestinal symptoms like eczema, headache, foggy mind, fatigue, depression, and so on. But not distinguished for celiac disease. So right now, we talk about gluten-related disorders with celiac disease, for which we have biomarkers, for wheat allergy that we have biomarkers, for gluten sensitivity, for which we do not have biomarkers, so we don't know how to make diagnosis. You should do something so complex that it's double-blind that nobody does. So bottom line, we are waiting for this, you know, biomarkers. I'm going to finish up with something that I believe is fascinating, that really intrigues a lot of people. What is this business of gluten with the brain? And again, there are a lot of stuff that are factual, some stuff that's work in progress, some that is, you know, fantasy, but you know, there being growing evidence that gluten can give in any given kind of spectrum of gluten-related disorders, issues like chronic short memory loss, anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, and blah, blah, blah. I'm pretty sure that you know about this autism business and the, you know, the implementation of gluten-free diet that is quite popular among kids with autism spectrum disorder and so on and so forth. But there's a lot of stuff that's going on in this domain. And I'm going to just finish with this last thing here, and then we can, you know, stop and do question and answer. The question is, how much gluten is too much? When we say gluten-free, we are not talking about zero, because such a thing does not exist. We're talking about an amount that is not visible to the immune system and will keep you healthy anyhow. There have been a lot of debate, there's been 10 years of discussion, the Food and Drug Administration finally decided to embrace this 20 parts per million and so on and so forth. How we reached that, there was a painful long, you know, research progress that brought us to declare 20 parts per million or below that to be safe for the vast majority of people with celiac disease. And again, there has been discussion at the Wazoo how this needs to be implemented and how it can be detected, how I'm sure that there's not going to be cross-contamination when I go out, and that we can discuss during Q&A and so on and so forth. This suffice to say that, you know, the gluten-free diet, the way that it's implemented right now, it's safe for the vast majority of people with celiac disease. Not all, again, because of the biological phenomena, there are extremes, but a vast majority of people with a gluten-free diet will tolerate this minuscule amount of gluten. If you want zero, as like people there will advocate, a slice of bread will cost you $300 because it has to be made in a special suit in this specific, you know, uncontaminated reality. And as soon as that piece of bread comes out, anyhow, start to be cross-contaminated no matter what. So zero is not feasible, so we have to be very practical in that. Okay, I was able to actually squeeze everything that I was supposed to in a relatively short period of time. I want to thank you all for taking the time on Sunday to come. And again, we can answer some few questions if you have any.
The notion of having celiac disease and gluten sensitivity. You ever, for kids who might
have
a gluten-free diet,
yes,
get six, a drop of a hat if they eat anything that might have
cross-contamination. That's right. So a kid that's diagnosed with celiac disease, go on a gluten-free diet and then eventually react immediately if exposed to a smell of gluten, is an individual that has celiac disease with extremely active immune system. It's not that I have two conditions, because the two are two different animals. Different cells involved, different machinery involved, so they cannot coexist in the same person. They can coexist in the same family. We see quite often that there's somebody in the family has celiac disease and somebody else has gluten sensitivity, because I don't know, the household goes all gluten-free, and all of a sudden I realize that the stomachache that I thought that was normal, and the headache that was part of my life, is gone. And then, you know, you say, oh my gosh, so this was gluten-driven, and then you test yourself for celiac disease, you're negative for, you know, celiac disease, and yet you benefit being on a gluten-free diet. So that can coexist in the same family, but not in the same individual, because, again, the fact that you react so fast and violently sometimes, it's not unusual. And the other thing that is, it's a misconception, is that if I'm diagnosed with celiac disease with, let's say, diarrhea and weight loss, and going on a gluten-free diet, the diarrhea, weight loss is gone. The next time, if I'm cross-contaminated, I have to experience the same symptom. Absolutely not true. You can experience totally different symptom. Nothing to do with the symptom that you start the story with. And again, you can be very lucky, i.e. that the smell of gluten will put you over the edge and you have symptoms right away, so you know when you're cross-contaminated, or very unlucky that you're cross-contaminated, you don't react for weeks, months, years until you develop a comorbidity. You know, Hashimoto, for example, that's extremely frequent. We were talking before that this comorbidity business is such a fascinating story because, you know, again, the machinery is the same and you can develop stuff because you're cross-contaminated all the time.
Yeah. If somebody has the gene but doesn't have the disease yet, but it's in the family, is there a good logic to keep them on a gluten-free diet?
No, absolutely not. And the reason why, because again, worst case scenario, you're in the same family, you have the genes, and you are homozygous, so you two copy these genes, there are more chances that you're not going to develop 60% than you will develop 40%. And the gluten-free diet, yes, it's a diet, but it's a therapeutic intervention. And as you know, it's not a walk in the park. You know, it's a highly invested, you know, change in lifestyle that is sustainable over time only if you have a return on investment, particularly in young kids that will become the teenagers. And at that age, your IQ will drop 200 points. And if you were the ones to say, you know what, you have to be gluten-free because you have the genes and we have celiac in the family, the guy will question you. And even if at that point it would be necessary because eventually he or she develops celiac disease, would be rebelling the idea. So definitely, I would not do preemptive, you know, implementation of gluten-free diet just simply based on the genetic compatibility.
Although if they continue, there is a 40% chance they develop.
But that's the reason why We do recommend, if you are part of a family with celiac disease, one, to be tested for celiac disease, and two, look for the genes. Because if you have the genes, that individual definitely needs to be scrutinized over time. You keep an eye on that fellow, because that can be somebody that may eventually develop celiac disease for sure. Yep.
And if you have celiac disease, you're strictly gluten-free, how, and your numbers resolve and everything's great, how often should you go to test for it? Maybe or perhaps do an endoscopy to just confirm.
That's a very good question. I mean, if this question was asked to me a few months ago, I said, no, you do the an endoscopic diagnosis and that's it. Unfortunately, and it's, I don't know if it's out already or it's coming out, we just published a paper that, you know, like in adults, even if a less, you know, percentage, but like in adults, there is a subgroup of kids that despite implementing the gluten-free diet, it's the book, so they don't cheat. As a matter of fact, the TTG goes back to normal, and the symptoms are gone. You repeat an endoscopy, 20% of them, they still have damaged intestine. And that worries us. You know, there is this, a higher number in adults where this happened, 30, 40%, that people question, maybe because, you know, when you're an adult, it takes much longer than a year to repair, or the biology of the gut is different, we don't know. For the kids, though, you know, a year on a gluten-free diet, we were absolutely adamantly sure that would be more than enough, particularly in the context of a disease that's under control clinically and with these immunological markers. And again, when you have an inflamed intestine, somebody is growing other than, you know, just using calories for day-to-day operation, it's worrisome. So. Our recommendation right now, our center right now, what it does is, one, we don't embrace the European revised, you know, guidelines that will eventually allow a subgroup of kids to not be endoscoped anymore for this reason, because, you know, we need to know that. Plus, if any of these drugs will come to fruition, insurance will not pay for the drugs unless you have a diagnosis based on endoscopy. I'm pretty sure that that will be their restriction there. And also because, again, you know, not everybody repairs. And if you don't repair, there are stuff that can be done. But what you need to know where you start from. So if you don't have a baseline endoscopy, it's difficult. If when you repeat the endoscopy and it's complete healed, then there is no need to repeat the endoscopy ever again unless, you know, extremely excruciating circumstances. The only thing that you need to do is to come to a center like this here and once a year, and, you know, be seen by a dietitian, be seen by a physician that knows about celiac disease, and repeat the antibodies to make sure that they're still normal. That's it. Yep.
Could you advocate pre and probiotics?
Do I advocate for pre or probiotics? Okay, we can discuss this until tomorrow. You know, since I started this job, I've been always fascinated by this crosstalk between microorganisms and us. At the beginning, at the single level, and then at this big community. So, and I'm, you know, very biased, as you probably heard, about the microbiome being such a big deal in creating problems on a specific genetic background. So, of course, anything that can manipulate the microbiome to help me to bring back peace in this ecosystem, it's a fair game. What is my concern here? That the first time ever in science, we're using something before we study how that works. So in other words, we're using pre and probiotics that you can buy. You get out of here, you go, you know, CVS. Without knowing, one, their composition, two, what exactly they're doing to us. We know that they don't harm, and that's the reason why we promiscuously use this. But are we sure that are not really jeopardizing what could be in the future a very, very powerful tool? Are we going to do the same mistake that we made with penicillin, for example? That when it was discovered, we thought that was the panacea to solve all the infection that we start to use promiscuously and see what kind of disaster we created. So that, you know, we have strains that are now resistant to penicillin, or we treat infection that would not respond to penicillin at all because, you know, our viral infection were gram-negative that don't respond to penicillin, and yet, because we use so much now, what was a superb tool is gone. I'm afraid that we are making the same mistake here. Matter of fact, both the Food and Drug Administration and the NIH now are really putting a brake on the use of probiotics. They want rules that I believe will be welcome in terms of, you know, what are the indications, where are the characteristics of these probiotics and prebiotics that they have to have? Because, you know, when you go there and you buy probiotics X for a surveil that was made by the Food and Drug Administration, sometimes there is no probiotics in that. Sometimes there is probiotics, but the load of probiotics is much lower than they claim. Sometimes there are pathogens and not probiotics in there. So that's the landscape that we leave. So this is a long way to answer your question. And probably, if really you want to exploit the benefits of probiotics, I will go natural, you know, yogurt, until, you know, the rules are in place and somebody will tell us how to play the game.
I think times are up, unfortunately, but you.
I need to take this last question from a young man. You know, allow me to do. Go for it.
Let's say there's an individual in which they have celiac disease and they've been on a gluten-free diet for over a year, yet the levels of their serums are still not going down. What are the possible causes for that?
Well, again, that means that the immune system is still the enemy. So that's something that can be harmful. These are the situations in which the dietitian needs to sit down, because 9 out of 10 times, not because you voluntarily, you know, eat good, but it's the cross-contamination. And, you know, there are a few tricks that, you know, eventually can be used. If the dietitian is not able to identify where this cross-contamination comes from, there is another way. There is a plan B, so to speak, so that you have to go for a little while on a diet in which you can't use any substitutes. You can eat only stuff that's naturally gluten-free, and that works most of the time. But there's no other way around, particularly your age, that a persistence of these antibodies is due to the fact that, you know, gluten contaminants could come in your body. Okay? All right. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.